Konbanwa. Good evening, as they say in Japanese. And it is indeed a wonderful moment for us, if I were to say, not just nostalgic, but even momentous, because a dream and vision that we had been carrying for quite some time. Today, the Japan Center at AMA, the Ahmedabad Management Association, and the Indo-Japan Friendship Association, we have been striving over the last so many years to do so many things. But the last 3 years has been like fast forward. You know, we've moved at a speed of Shinkansen, and that has been possible because of our chief guest this evening. Let us welcome him with a big round of applause. His Excellency, Ambassador Mr. Sujan Chinoy. And we would also like to welcome, I'm sure if Japan had to someday pick an ambassador from Gujarat, it would have been an obvious choice, not just a smart, handsome man, as he is in the pictures, both of them look so brilliant, but one who has poured in his heart with a zeal, vision, and mission of our own, and very near and dear, the Chief Secretary of the Government of Gujarat, Dr. J.N. Singh. But minasan, ladies and gentlemen, as they say in Japanese, just think of it. We are in 2018 now. 40 years ago, in the year 1978, a young gentleman of 20 years from Gujarat, he visited Japan for the first time, and they were all known as unofficial ambassadors of not only Gujarat, but India. Who had dreamt, perhaps except him, that a day will come 40 years later when he would be sitting in this kingdom of his as the official ambassador of India to Japan, and he's none else but Sujan Chinoy. Because the story started, as I mentioned, in 1978, and we have the Vice Chancellor of the Gujarat University, Dr. Himanshu Pandya. Let's welcome him. This is going to be acknowledged in the year 2020-21 as the Golden Jubilee Exchange Program, which no other university in India has, and perhaps the ambassador could correct me, at least to my knowledge, except for the Otomon Gakuin, of which you are both, you and me are both alumni. I was inspired just a few years ago before you, but Otomon has OGU, and I'm so glad later on I'll ask for raising hands, and we have so many of our alumni, not just one generation, two generations who've gone and come back from Japan. So friends, but then there are many unknown things about the ambassador that I would like to reveal. Please don't worry about it. This is no scamster. There are such wonderful things I can share about him. In fact, I could go on talking about him, but a couple of things that I think I must acknowledge and mention here. I don't know, sir, Dr. Jain Singh would perhaps recall, if in the Indian Foreign Service you could think of one diplomat who knows 11 languages, national and international. And I just don't want to say that 11 and keep you guessing. The 11, of course, start with our own Gujarati, Hindi, Urdu, English. But then Chinese, and he speaks fluent Chinese. And I don't think we've had an ambassador to Japan who speaks fluent Japanese as well. So over all these four decades, he has kept up his Japanese. But then he also knows French, German, Arabic, Spanish, and Creole. That makes it 11 languages. Doesn't it call for a big round of applause? Amazing, amazing. Born in royal family in Rajkot, studied at the Rajkumar College. You know, even today, he could be called a Rajkumar when he rides his horses. He's very fond of horse riding, very fond of archery, you know, at which again he's so good. I wish next time he could come and even play sitar for us, which he did as ambassador of Mexico on 2nd of October a few years ago. So versatile a person he is. But more than that, I could go on talking about him. I only want to say a very warm-hearted, understanding, affectionate person. We've cherished a friendship for over four decades, but it always feels good when you say that your friend is His Excellency the Ambassador. It gives you a special feel. And so many of us would be feeling the same way who know him. Because at least today, he is the only Gujarati ambassador in Indian Foreign Service. And we do not know when the next one may come. Well, friends, I should also say something about our guest of honor, Dr. J.N. Singh. In fact, Dr. Singh was, I would say, it would not be an overstatement to say he was baptized into Japan by His Excellency the Ambassador himself when they accidentally met in Delhi. And I recall it was exactly a year ago, Dr. J.N. Singh, Madam Thara, and the trio, Sri M.K. Das. The three of them, at a very short notice, but at the very affectionate persuasion of the ambassador, they traveled to Japan. And since then, Dr. Singh has just not looked back. Of course, he is one of those very few and enviable, you can say, chief secretaries who is going to get his double share of vibrance. It was 2017, as you all know, when he took over in 2016 and 2019. In fact, I reminded him, Your Excellency, a few days ago when we met at the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry, when my dear friend Dr. Jaimin Vasa was there, because the chamber had led recently a delegation about a year later after our goodwill delegation visited. And let me say, that visit would just not have been possible and so successful but for the ambassador. I have more things to say on him later, but Dr. Singh, I think, will agree that he's one man who's inspired, motivated, and moved so many of us. And Your Excellency, I was mentioning to him that 2019 will be a decade of participation by Japan as a country partner. It was in 2009. And to take you through some of these beautiful golden moments that we cherish here, and as the title says, Kemche Konnichiwa, five decades of Gujarat's vibrant bonding with Japan, which started in the 70s and will touch 50 years very soon. Let's enjoy this very brief but absorbing film. Please, lights. Yeah.
delighted to know in Ahmedabad now, in the past 5 years, Ahmedabad Management Association has given more than 500 Japanese language students.
Center will be the ABC, the academic, business, and cultural.
Distinguished honor of the Order of the Rising Sun, gold rays with rosette, has been conferred by the Emperor of Japan on Mr. Mukesh Patel, President of the Indo-Japan Friendship Association.
Friends, namaste, konnichiwa. It gives me great pleasure to convey my warmest greetings on the occasion of the 6th Japan Festival. The festival celebrates the MOU concluded between Gujarat and Hyogo in Kobe on 12 November 2016. It was a privilege for me to sign the MOU on behalf of Gujarat, my home state. I am confident the MOU will foster even closer economic, cultural, and people-to-people ties between Gujarat and Hyogo.
Yoko so Gujarat, swagatam Gujarat ma. Yoko so Gujarat, swagatam Gujarat ma.
friends, actually every Gujarati should be having on his or her lips, Kem Che Konnichiwa. You saw that even Madam Aki Abe, accompanied by the two first ladies of both the ambassadors, Ambassador Chinoy, Madam Vidya Chinoy, and Ambassador Hiramatsu's better half, Madam Patricia Hiramatsu, they were all here. And with what zeal and spirit. But all this, whether we talk of Madam Abe, we talk of the signing of the MOU between Hyogo and Gujarat, our delegation going there, even the ambassador won the hearts of the youngsters, you know, and from the Genesis program who went. And this was all possible. And friends, I want you to give a thunderous applause, because Gujarat and Japan would not have come so near but for Ambassador Chinoy. May I, on behalf of all of us, take this opportunity to welcome His Excellency Mr. Sujan Chinoy, the Ambassador of India to Japan. And may I request the president of the Ahmedabad Management Association and my dear friend, Mr. Rajiv Mehta, to welcome very warmly Dr. J.N. Singh. Gujarat is blessed in terms of water, in terms of petroleum. When we think of it, we think of you, sir, as your glorious term, as MD of the Sardar Sarovar Narmada Nigam, as MD of the Gujarat State Petroleum Corporation. And friends, I want to just take a couple of minutes. We want to take this moment to present our heartfelt greetings and felicitations to a man who truly deserves that. But I would like to mention, because many of you might not be aware, see, in fact, he's not even completed 3 years officially in Japan. He joined on 3rd of December 2015. And in a tenure of just about 28 months, if I mistake not, he has made so many significant milestones in terms of achievement in India-Japan relations. I think a few things are very noteworthy and need to be mentioned here. As you are aware, we have these annual visits of the two prime ministers going from one to the other country. After Ambassador Chinoy took over in 2015, it was in November of 2016 that Prime Minister Modi visited Japan, and imagine in that one single visit, thanks to the Herculean efforts of Ambassador Chinoy, as many as 10 historic agreements between India and Japan, including the Japan civil nuclear deal, they came to be concluded. And it took him just one more year to do something which was phenomenal. It has never ever happened in the history of Gujarat. Because even when we had the Chinese premier who visited Ahmedabad, he did think of visiting at least Delhi. But thanks to Ambassador Chinoy's perhaps mesmerism, the Abes decided that it is Ilu Ilu only with Guju, and Gujus alone. They landed here and they took off from here in 2017, September, but not without an achievement of another 16 agreements pioneered by Ambassador Chinoy, making the tally to 25 in 2 years. In 2 years, 25 MOUs, including, you know, cooperation in disaster risk management, Japanese language education, connectivity, civil aviation, investment, science, technology, sports, whatnot. And friends, perhaps one of the biggest landmark of that 2017 September visit was the groundbreaking ceremony of the flagship Mumbai-Ahmedabad high-speed rail project, popularly known as, now everybody knows, you don't have to explain when you talk about Shinkansen, right? You don't even need to say bullet train. People know that Shinkansen is it. In fact, the ambassador came a little early today and he said that Shinkansen does reach its destination early at times. It was, I would say, a tribute to Ahmedabad and its traffic as well, maybe. Well, friends, the Railway Training Institute was set up through his inspiration, but a very cherished relationship Ambassador Chinoy has enjoyed is with the Japanese Foreign Minister, Taro Kono, who has been a great friend of India, and Ambassador Chinoy. He would never say no to him, you know, whether it's the Republic Day or it's a Hanami reception, you know, the cherry blossom party that he throws. On all occasions, the foreign minister, Taro Kono-san, is there at his beck and call. Speaks volumes for the kind of goodwill that he has generated in the political circles in Japan. On the economic front, friends, again, something absolutely outstandingly noteworthy. In FY 2016-17, the year when he took over, there was a growth of over 80% in terms of the Japanese investment, foreign direct investment in India. The previous year, it was $2.6 billion. And during his tenure, he stepped it up to $4.7 billion, a whopping 80% rise. Amazing. And whether it is startups, digital and innovation sectors, whatever, one of the most absorbing things I think you can go on the net and get is when you talk about Make in India, he said, Make in India, the Japan focus, and how the Japanese companies could use the Make in India focus. He has done some wonderful work. Maybe he would like to also share this evening with us today. Friends, in terms of official development assistance, ODA as we call it, Japan has continued its highest allocations to India. But another very significant achievement during the tenure of the ambassador in FY 2017-18, $384.1 billion Japanese yen in ODA pledged to India by Japan, and this makes India the single largest recipient of assistance from Japan compared to any other country. You know, number one contribution. India gets the biggest from Japan. Japan is also the biggest giver. I think this is amazing. Skill development, wonderful initiatives taken. He has relentlessly pursued the India-Japan cooperation. But in the presence, august presence of the Honorable Chief Secretary, I should mention one of the most important things, apart from Shinkansen and the Railway Institute, and you know, our madam will agree, the Japanese lovely industrial parks that are not just one, but two of them now coming up, where again, along with the government of Gujarat and its very pioneering efforts, thanks to sir, you and your team. And I would like to, on this occasion, take opportunity to, because they are our very close friends, breaking protocol on this side, may I take this opportunity to request that we present flowers to two of our friends and well-wishers from the government of Gujarat who have supported us in a big way. I would request Radhika, you know, she is one of our Genesis students, to present to Madam Thara Friends, you know the Vice Chairman and Managing Director of GIDC. And Madam, we would call you separately someday to share your experiences and thoughts of what you did in Japan and what you are doing in Gujarat for Japan here sometime, along with the Honorable Chief Secretary. We would also like to acknowledge the very gracious presence of our Managing Director of the Index B, Mr. Rajkumar Beniwal, and may I request Mr. Nilesh Dave, the Joint Secretary of our association, to present flowers to Mr. Beniwal. They have been, Mr. Beniwal of Index B, sir, you are aware, the Hyogo Gujarat pioneering relationship initiated by him. We have nurtured it, you know, in our own way, AMA and the Japan Center, Indo-Japan Association, Gujarat Chamber of Commerce followed suit. In fact, they are now all waiting for you and the Honorable Chief Minister to reciprocate, you know, because friends, I'm sure many of you, I know these faces were there. We went 11 of us. The Japanese came, they were so thrilled with our visit. They came in four times the number, 44 of them, led by Governor Toshizo Ido. Mr. Beniwal is a witness to that. We wish that the Hyogo-Gujarat relations really grow stronger. So friends, this is a moment to celebrate, to cherish, and on behalf of all of us, those who have known Ambassador Chinoy, in fact, it was so beautiful to see that he came and he met friends 40 years, 30 years, 20 years down the line and mingled around. It was just like homecoming. We are grateful to him and of course to you, sir, at a very short notice, and to others for making it. May I now take this opportunity of requesting Dr. Singh on our behalf, and all of us will join in presenting this lovely citation, which he richly deserves. You know, I just said this because it was just to give you a glimpse that there was no overstatement or exaggeration in anything that I said about him. Presented to His Excellency Mr. Sujan Chinoy for your illustrious and momentous tenure as Ambassador of India to Japan since 3rd December 2015. With deepest admiration and appreciation for your sterling and noteworthy contribution in strengthening bilateral relations between India and Japan, your pioneering and visionary role in meaningfully promoting Gujarat and Japan ties on academic, business, and cultural fronts, and last but not the least, what we always would cherish even after your retirement, whenever it comes, is for being our most inspiring friend, philosopher, and guide. On behalf of the Ahmedabad Management Association, the Indo-Japan Friendship Association, and the Japan Information and Study Center, I would request all of you to please rise, giving a thunderous applause as I request the Honorable Chief Secretary to join us. Well, it's time to now also make some presentations. I would request our Vice President of the Indo-Japan Friendship Association and the former director of our student exchange program, Ms. Malti Mehta, to present a shawl to His Excellency the Ambassador as a mark of our respect and admiration for him. And as I mentioned,
He has always been our friend, philosopher, and guide, as was Lord Krishna for Arjun, as our great Bhagavad Gita says. And therefore, we thought on our behalf we should present him the chariot, and he can visualize in what role he is. May I request the Honorary Vice President of the Indo-Japan Friendship Association and Treasurer of AMA, Mr. Divyesh Radia, to please present this lovely chariot to Thank you very much, Divyesh Bhai. Well, friends, I would like to acknowledge, as I mentioned earlier, the special presence of two of our very close friends. We have the Vice Chancellor of the Gujarat University, Dr. Himanshu Pandya, and he must be feeling so proud. Of course, how old you were in 1978 or 1972 when I went, I don't know. But at least in your own right, you have every reason to be proud and felicitate. May we request you to please present university's felicitations and greetings to the ambassador, flowers, and a gift. Dr. Himanshu Pandya, friends, as you all know, Ambassador Chinoy was a student where he graduated in MBA with marketing from the BK School of Business Management. And all BKites, I know they are here in a big number as well, feeling very proud for this moment. And I would also like to request recently who has taken over, and he led as the senior vice president the chamber's delegation. He's now officially the president of the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Dr. Jaimin Vasa, to present a memento on behalf of the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry to His Excellency Sujan Chinoy. Thank you, Jaimin Bhai. Thank you very much. And may I? Let's do all the we have exchange students, we have delegation members. You can rise. Of course, those who went in the delegation, please rise. I'm sure they are very happy to be here. We acknowledge presence. Now I must ask a few others to also relax their muscles. And may I request, sir, please take seat. But may I request, perhaps in a very large congregation, we have the alumni of the Otemon and the Gujarat University Exchange Program. Would all of the alumni friends stand up, please? Oh, they are there. Lovely. Don't think it was only a ladies' program. The ladies have made it this evening. And I'm glad we have from the 70s, 80s, 90s, and even the last decade, the current decade as well. Thank you very much. I would request those who went under the Genesis program and met His Excellency the Ambassador, please come and rise. The whole team is also here. We are very happy to have you. Sir, this is just to remind you that once you meet somebody, they don't forget you. how affectionately you have welcomed and treated them. So we are very happy that they're all here. And the presentations need to be completed with the complete circle of the Japan-Gujarat friendship. And I would request our honorary treasurer, Mr. Sandeep Shah, to present a memento of our Japan Center. Sir, you have been with us for the first time. To Dr. J.N. Singh, friends, please. Thank you so much. Sir, this will remind you of your visit to the Japan Center. And of course, we would also be presenting a few other souvenirs, etc. We'll take care of them. Well, it's time now to put the pleasantries at a stop
and invite for what all of us have gathered here this evening. We look forward to a very scintillating address on India-Japan relations, potential and prospects. I wonder what language he's going to choose to speak out of the 11. Sir, at least give us some flavor of Gujarati, because what I wanted to say about you, and well, this is not something which is homemade because it's on Wikipedia. Friends, the ambassador, amongst many other things, he has also performed a cameo role in a Gujarati film titled Sorath No Singh Chel Bhai. So let us welcome Sorath No Singh from Rajkot, who lives in Tokyo, His Excellency Ambassador Sujan Chinoy. Please, Your Excellency.
Thank you, Mr. Mukesh Patel. I want to begin by acknowledging the distinguished presence of the Honorable Chief Secretary of Gujarat, Dr. Jayan Singh, and all the other distinguished guests that are present on the dais today, too numerous to name individually by name. I am overwhelmed by these very warm words that you've expressed, Mukesh Bhai, in the language of love and affection. And so I hope to reciprocate with a few words of my own, expressing my deepest sentiments. There are today in the audience people who represent every stage of my life. If I've known you for 40 years, I know others from my alma mater, the Rajkumar College, my seniors, Punjawala of Mandawad, Nipendra Singh Khachar of Jasdan, and many others, too numerous to name, who have seen me from the time I was a toddler, from the time 50 years ago. They've seen me as a young boy of 6 years old joining the Rajkumar College, and I probably was also bullied by one or two of them. I acknowledge with great humility the presence of those that have turned up from Gujarat University, those that were either senior to me at the BK School of Business Management or junior to me, those that went on the exchange program to Japan. Again, too numerous to acknowledge each one by name. And so it is with a sense of deep emotion that I stand before you and state that I'm a very proud Kathiawadi from Rajkot, but I also consider Ahmedabad to be special to me because I was born in this city. It is my Janmabhumi. It is therefore, in a sense, my true Matrubhumi. And while my Karmabhumi has been various parts of the world, I have always made it a point to come back to Gujarat, no matter from what part of the world, to touch base with reality and to feel the goodwill and the emotions that are to be found here in great abundance. Sir Winston Churchill had once said that he was going to make a long speech simply because he had had no time to prepare a shorter one. But I am a little wiser, and I think that it would be proper for me to leave the audience before the audience leaves me. And if I were to see you sitting on the edge of your chairs while I speak, I want to firmly believe that you're doing so because you're greatly interested in what I'm saying, and not because you're desirous of leaving as quickly as possible. But to begin with, let me acknowledge the fact that Gujarat, this great state, vibrant and dynamic, with people, human resources that are second to none in the world, has always been a globalized state. And the relationship between Gujarat and Japan goes back several decades. In fact, Gujarat is one of the states, few states in India, that reached out to Japan in those early days, when the interest in Japan was not as high as today. And we see that under the dynamic Strait administration today, led by Dr. Jayan Singh and his very capable and able team, we see the fruits of this labor that has been put in by not just the Indo-Japan Friendship Association, not just by the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce, by the Ahmedabad Management Association, by the university, but also by the people of Gujarat, by the industrialists of Gujarat. And it is with good reason today that you have a very good relationship between Gujarat and the state of Hyogo, a relationship which began in trying times at the time of the great earthquake in 2001 when Hyogo extended a helping hand. And we have seen this partnership blossom during the leadership of the state by Prime Minister Narendra Modi as Chief Minister, when he went several times to Japan and renewed his friendship with the governor of Hyogo. And so it is with good reason that you have very large number of Japanese investments today pouring into Gujarat, making full use of the ease of business that we present here, the reforms that are being conducted in this state. The biggest project, of course, the best known, the most exciting one is the Shinkansen, but there are many others. I want to say a few words about this great relationship that we have between India and Japan, and to put it in a broader historical context. Our ties with Japan go back to the earliest days. They are founded on the celestial bridges and foundation of Buddhism, Hindu-Buddhist thought and philosophy. It is a trouble-free relationship. There are no bilateral disputes between India and Japan. And Buddhism, which enriched humankind with its values of peace and nonviolence and tolerance and assimilation and inclusive growth of society, spread from India to East Asia and then on to Japan. And we see vestiges and the legacy of this in things like the words in the Japanese language which come from Sanskrit, such as seva, which means exactly the same thing in Japanese as it does in Indian languages, or the word goma, which comes from the Sanskrit word homa, which we use for our religious rites and practices, or the word tori for an archway, which comes from the Sanskrit word toran. And beyond that, we have seen the role played by Zen Buddhism in Japan, the iconic role played by Daruma, the figure that is so widely popular in Japan. And very few people in either Japan or in India know that Daruma is none other than Bodhidharma. Bodhidharma, who in the 5th century founded Zen Buddhism as the Chan school of Buddhism in China. And the word Zen, or Chan in Chinese, as it's known, comes from Dhyan, as in Dhyan meditation, Dhyan yoga. And so these are these ties that bound us together over the centuries. And when we move into the latter part of the 19th century, we are struck by the fact that the Meiji restoration in 1860 enabled Japan to free itself from the fetters of the past, the historical limitations that they believed their own culture and values had placed on them. And they modernized, they adopted modern science and technology, Western ways, and we have seen for ourselves how Japan rose since then to become one of the most formidable economies and scientific and technological powers in the world. And it is with good reason, therefore, that Swami Vivekananda said in 1893, after having visited Yokohama on his way to Chicago for the World Conference of Religions, he wrote in an epistle, in a letter to the son of a friend 10 years later, that he would like to see every young Indian visit Japan at least once in his or her lifetime, because there is so much to learn from that great country. And he hoped very much that these young people would bring back those values and best practices from Japan in order to become the nuclei of further change and progress in Indian society. There are figures like Rabindranath Tagore, like Rash Bihari Bose, Subhash Chandra Bose, and above all, Judge Radha Binod Pal, who are very famous in Japan for the kind of stellar work that they've done. Their contributions have been widely acknowledged in terms of bringing the two peoples closer together. When we look at the modern context of our ties, we are struck by the fact that over the last 40 years, the global engines of growth and economic change moved from traditional centers in Europe and America to Asia. And we saw that in the rise of China, which grew at an unbridled pace of 9% or more for approximately 3 decades. But the fact of the matter is that Asia is a vast continent with very different cultures, a mind-boggling variety of peoples and countries, with a history of civilizational linkages, but not excluding disputes, maritime or border. And it is in this vast continent that 60% of the global population resides. Asia is also the fastest growing continent in the world in terms of GDP growth. But it is not China alone that has grown in recent years. Apart from China, it is dynamic economies like India, Indonesia, Thailand, Malaysia, and many others, the Philippines included, that have shown 6% or higher rates of growth consistently over a very long period of time. And today, therefore, we see that Japan remains the world's second largest developed economy, the third largest in nominal terms. It remains a formidable power with deep resources, financial and capital, and unparalleled technologies. It is a country that spends the highest amount per capita on R&D in the world, and the results are therefore all to see. It leads in innovation, it leads in terms of IT, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things. But Japan has a diminishing and declining and aging population. It has an economy that grew very well from the period 1959 to 1979 at approximately 9%, but thereafter flattened out for many decades. And today, it is a cause of celebration when the Japanese economy grows at, say, 1.9%. That's a great performance for the Japanese economy. But the fact of the matter is that the Japanese today look at India in new light. They no longer look at India as the land of elephants or snake charmers. For a large number of changes are taking place back home in India today under dynamic leadership of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Since 2014, you've seen, ladies and gentlemen, a very large number of changes taking place in the Indian economy, reforms that have fundamentally altered the trajectory of India's growth. We have brought about changes such as the establishment of commercial courts. We have passed legislation for the insolvency and bankruptcy code. Above all, we have put in place a unified market through the introduction of the goods and services tax. All this makes for an improvement in terms of the ease of doing business in India. And India today, therefore, is logically rising as a great economic power in its own right, with growth rates of 7.4% for this year, 7.8% for next year. The Japanese have been mindful of the great opportunities that India therefore offers, as it has a number of flagship initiatives such as smart cities, digital India, startup India, and so on and so forth. And above all, the Make in India program has greatly attracted Japanese companies. The Indian economy today is absorbing up to $60 billion worth of FDI. These are figures that we associated in the past only with an economy of the size of China. These were not figures that we associated with the Indian economy. But today it's a reality. It's a reality because India is changing rapidly in terms of its economy and the kind of processes that have been set into motion. The Japanese today, therefore, increasingly look at India as a very large and favorable destination for their own investments. It is a scalable alternative to the long-standing investments that they have placed in the Chinese economy. It's true. The Japan-China economic partnership is possibly 10 times bigger than the Japan-India partnership, and their investments in China are of an altogether higher magnitude and order. But we have cause for celebration that Japan has today emerged as one of the largest investors in India. As Mr. Mukesh Patel just mentioned, the figures are quite astounding that the cumulative investments made by Japan in the Indian economy stand at approximately $26.2 billion, even if we don't add the latest figures. And it is only next to Singapore and Mauritius, which are actually platforms for multiple source investment. So to my mind, Japan is, single country-wise, the number one investor in India. Japan has also put in something like $4.7 billion in the financial year 2016-17 alone. And what is more, what is interesting is the nature of the Japanese presence in India is changing. Japan sees India today in an altogether new light, as I mentioned, and the opportunities, therefore, are numerous. It is not just the manufacturing sector which is attracting the Japanese industry into India. Japan is also coming in a big way into other unexplored, heretofore unexplored sectors, such as the financial sector, such as logistics and services. And more recently, we've been working with Japan in capacity building, in skills development, and other programs. I might cite here that this relationship, which is now better known as our Special Strategic and Global Partnership, would not have reached these heights but for the fact that the two prime ministers, Prime Minister Modi on our side and Prime Minister Abe in Japan, have a wonderful personal rapport. But it is not just this rapport alone that is the driving force. The rapport between the two prime ministers has provided great impetus to this partnership. It has inspired us to work harder. And therefore, there are a great many more stakeholders in this emerging partnership than in the past. And these stakeholders include parliamentarians. They include people like you, the universities, the think tanks, the chambers of commerce, the state governments, all of whom are actually looking at this with great hope in regard to the future. Prime Minister Modi, most recently, I recall, said in Singapore on the 1st of June, in his keynote address at the Shangri-La dialogue, that our relations with Japan, both strategic and economic, have fundamentally changed in recent years, and that this is a partnership of great substance, which is also the cornerstone of our Look East and Act East policy, today better known as our Act East policy. Prime Minister has also said on a number of occasions, including in Ahmedabad last year during the visit of Prime Minister Abe, that perhaps no country has played a bigger role in the modernization of India as has Japan. And perhaps no country will play a bigger role in the attainment of the aspirations of our billion plus people as will Japan in the future. So it is a partnership that is central to what is emerging in the Indo-Pacific in the 21st century. There are large projects providing connectivity. Japan's presence, as you know, is well known in infrastructure. It is the country that enabled us to get the iconic Delhi Metro off its feet. It's one of the finest examples of urban connectivity. There are a number of other metros across India where Japan is also playing a role. Quite apart from high-speed rail, Shinkansen, and other infrastructure like roads, bridges, tunnels, we have to keep in mind that Japan has best practices and technologies that are second to none, and that we stand to gain when we combine our own demand, this huge market that we have here, the democratic setup that we provide, the demographic dividend that we provide in terms of our rich and youthful and well-trained and capable human resources, to the Japanese technology and capital that is looking for alternative destinations. So we are at a stage in our relationship where there's great hope for the future. When we look at the broader region, there are many other reasons for India and Japan to work together. The popular perception, of course, remains that India and Japan are coming together because it's a strategic necessity of the times, and that there is great geopolitical and geostrategic change taking place in the Indo-Pacific, and therefore India and Japan are coming together. But nothing could be further from the truth. It remains true that we have shared values as democracies. It remains true that we are wedded to the rule of law, to transparency and openness, that we agree that this vast Indo-Pacific region through which all the important sea lanes of trade, commerce, and communication pass must be kept open and available to all, as the Prime Minister himself said in Singapore. It is true that we seek freedom of navigation and overflight in the region without any kind of unilateral restrictions being placed, but it is not true that the Indo-Japan partnership is directed at any third country. So we must keep in mind that the fundamental logic of the India-Japan partnership lies in a bigger truth, and that truth really is the truth and the reality of India's great potential as an economy, the kind of opportunities that it is offering to the world today, including to Japan. It remains true, therefore, that the central plank of our emerging partnership in the 21st century is really the economic reality, where the two can come together, not only to create opportunities for one another, but also to work together for the betterment of the region. And it is in that broad context that we work together under the concept of free and open Indo-Pacific strategy, which has been spoken about and written about a great deal, and a proposal that the Japanese have been pushing for a while. We share those values, we work with them in the region, we are committed to working together all along the Asia-Africa growth corridor to provide better connectivity, to provide better examples of financing that do not put countries into debt or hock and cause stress in terms of their ability to pay these loans back. So there is a great deal that we can do together. And I also want to say a few words about our defense partnership. This is an area that has recently emerged. India and Japan are now engaged in a full spectrum dialogue between the three services. We have a defense dialogue at the defense minister's level, at the secretary, Ministry of Defense's level. We also have a great deal more engagement between the three services of our armed forces. Japan, as you may know, in the strategic Indian Ocean region, is present in terms of its anti-piracy operations in the Gulf of Aden. And currently, it is a member of the Combined Task Force 151, and CTF 151, in fact, is a multinational force. We are not a part of it. Japan is, in fact, heading that force in the form of a Japanese admiral. India is also present in this vast ocean as an independent navy in the Gulf of Aden and conducting its own anti-piracy operations. So we've decided that their assets, both air, naval, and others that pass through the region, stop by in India and exercise with us, whether it is PASEX or whether it is humanitarian assistance and disaster relief on the high seas, or whether it is other forms of engagement between our Navy, Air Force, and in the Coast Guard as well. This year, we will work on the first ever army-to-army counterinsurgency exercise between India and Japan. And I dare say that will be the first time that the self-defense forces of Japan would have engaged in this form of an exercise with any country. It stands to reason that they would do it with a very friendly country like India, with whom they share values. I also want to mention that cultural side of our engagement is something that really excites me. India's soft power, yoga, the fact that India is the land of Buddhism is something that is deeply appreciated by the Japanese people. Yoga, in fact, has taken Japan by storm. We are truly inspired by Prime Minister Modi's initiative at the United Nations in 2015, with the UN declaring the June 21st of each year as the International Day of Yoga. And we have been consistently celebrating this great event in Japan. I must tell you that we have managed to convince Japanese parliamentarians also to form a parliamentary league for the promotion of yoga. This is the first ever country in the world to have done so. We therefore celebrated last week the International Day of Yoga in the Japanese Diet, with the Japanese parliamentarians also engaged in this exercise. I have seen in my tenure there that there is such great promise in this relationship that we need the support of all parts of our civil society. The states in particular are reaching out to Japan in an unprecedented manner. Japan, under Dr. Jane Singh's leadership, Mr. M.K. Das, Mrs. Thara, and her team are all superb professionals. And I recall with great fondness the visit that you paid to Japan last year. There are a number of seminars. I could see the kind of interest they have in Gujarat. There is a greater degree of trust when it comes to Gujarat. There is greater sort of confidence in the fact that Gujarat has this great tradition of being open and transparent and providing the right kind of environment and ecosystem for Japanese companies to prosper. So with these few words, I think I should actually stop by simply saying that the future is there for us all to grasp. I would like to go on a little more, but I should restrict what I have to say. If you've enjoyed what I have said, if you appreciated these words that I have shared with you, well and good. Otherwise, I hope you've enjoyed your nap. Thank you very much.
I think that was an absolutely scintillating address, as His Excellency the Ambassador spoke from his heart. And friends, I'm only reminded of
the words you referred to, the Prime Minister Modi and his passion for Japan. See, he first visited in 2007, then 2012. In 2012, his words, they still ring in my ears, you know, when he said that Japan has experience and Gujarat has entrepreneurship. Japan has technology and Gujarat has youth power. Japan is insistent on discipline and values. Gujarat has the zeal for perfection. I'm mentioning this because I was mentioning to our Chief Secretary, I think I was not the only one to give you a tribute, it was even His Excellency the Ambassador who admired the trio's role, you know, and you captivated so many hearts. But the last sentence, I think, sir, is what inspires us truly when Prime Minister Modi said, together, Gujarat and Japan can create a great future. I want to see mini Japan in Gujarat. Sir, you are the captain who can bring this mini Japan here in Gujarat. And what is your vision? What are your plans? May we request you to please come and share your vision. Friends, a big round of applause for Dr. Jain Singh, because a vibrant state needs a vibrant Chief Secretary as well.
Thank you. Ambassador Chinoy, dear friends. Chinoy, sir, you can see the dignitaries on the dais, the institutions that they represent. Chamber of Commerce, which is the premier body in Gujarat, representing the industries. Ahmedabad Management Association, again at the pinnacle of the management teaching and the management knowledge in Gujarat. Gujarat University, of course, the Vice Chancellor is representing it. And the Indo-Japanese Friendship, represented by Mr. Mukesh Patel and friends. All of us have gathered here to honor you, to felicitate you, the work that you have put in throughout your career, and particularly in fostering, in encouraging, in strengthening the India-Japanese relation. And because you are from Gujarat, you have gone a long way, a big way, in fostering Gujarat and Japan relations. Thank you, sir. On a slightly humorous note, I mean, he has given a scintillating speech, no doubt, but full of facts. Let me bring some humor. Sir, there has been three members or three persons who have done this Japanese exchange program. You have been there, Dr. Mukesh Patel has been there, and you know Mr. Mayur Shah. All the three, it has apparently been such a rigorous course that you have lost some hair, all the three of you. So maybe the course was very, very rigorous. So the future, I mean, you had also been there. So perhaps, I mean, the future persons will have to take some risk in going there. On a more serious note, I'm very sure that the Vice Chancellor of Gujarat University must be feeling heartily pleased and satisfied that his predecessors encouraged this thing, encouraged this course, and because of that, two alumni on the dais represent one of the finest traditions. But for this course, I mean, certainly this course has gone a long way in fostering our relation with Japan. So the future people, I mean, irrespective of the loss of hair, you have a great future. No, I would also like to advise, slightly gratuitous advice, uncalled for, unsolicited advice, but as Chief Secretary, one keeps on giving advice. That try to, I mean, in your tenure, try to build such relationship as we have with Japan, and 40 years, what was started 40 years back, we can see the results. I mean, one ambassador and one, I mean, he has been honored by Japan, and so many other people, many of the young students, very young ones also are there. So try to develop some sort of linkage with other countries as well. I mean, this you can start. That will be your contribution for a long term, and maybe 30, 40 years hence, somebody else will talk that, yes, Mr. Himanshu Pandey had started this, and this has brought results. So you must do that. Japan is referred as the land of rising sun. Well, rising sun, yes, but it merges the ancient traditions with the modern technology. It's one of the most perfect nations. And we in government, Tara, Rajkumar, they are all witness to it, that they take a very, very long time to decide, come to some decision. Very long time. I mean, and we feel slightly frustrated. As Indians, we have got the habit, MOU, patapat sign kar do. Baad mein jo hoga, dekhenge. I mean, we'll keep on modifying. But the Japanese people are extremely perfect. You have said perfection for me. I mean, nothing to beat the Japanese. But once they decide on something, once they feel perfect about something, they stick to it. And then they go way ahead. See, I'll tell you the example when initially the Maruti was to come over here, the Suzuki company. They made lots of places, they went to lots of places, and ultimately they decided over here. And because they came, the first decision that they made, one unit, second unit, and now the third unit. And lo and behold, this is perhaps going to be the biggest unit, Tara, biggest unit in the world, as we say, sure? Biggest unit in the world producing cars. So this is the perfection of the decision. And well, we in the government have to support it. And because we support it strongly, therefore they feel confident. Ambassador Chinoy mentioned that, and Mukesh Bhai also endorsed, that they feel something good about Gujarat, that they keep on coming here and that they keep on building the relation further. We were in Japan, I mean, during that government tour, the government delegation, and there was huge amount of rainfall, I mean, last year. You are all aware of it. This time, fortunately, we don't expect that type of rainfall or that type of, I mean, cloudburst. North Gujarat, Banaskantha, Patan, I mean, areas where there is hardly any rain. But there in 24 or 48 hours, such huge rain that we were all mightily apprehensive that rainfall would enter the Maruti plant or the Suzuki plant, and then they will say, why did we go to Gujarat? It's an area of flood and all. So we had to take adequate care. And this is the type of support from the government side we gave. We put special engineers going there. We put up the suction plants, the motor to pump out water so that there would be no rain water or nothing should enter. And that we took care. So that is why the confidence has built. See, the links, as Ambassador has said, go all the way to their Buddhism. But interestingly, when I was trying to, doing some research, we hardly get time to do research, but doing some amount of study as to how the Buddhism went there, it did not go directly. Unlike it went to other part of Southeast Asia, to Indonesia, to even Korea, it did not go to Japan directly from India. It went through Korean route, it went through Chinese route. And that's why it was not Hinayana. I mean, we have got the two major wings, Mahayana and Hinayana in Buddhism. The Hinayana was there, but the Hinayana adopted a typical Buddhist Japanese form, and Zen Buddhism, Nara Buddhism, a different type. But yes, ultimately they are Buddhist, and Buddhism, more than Shinto, is the religion perhaps, what I read was about 40% of the people follow Buddhism, much more than what they do in India. Even in the place where I come from, Bihar, there is very few Buddhists, but Japan is a land of Buddhists. And once we go there, we feel so proud of it. So many tall statues of Buddha. I mean, we feel proud that we come from India where we are the progenitor of this religion, but Japan and the rest of the Southeast Asia has given Buddhism a big color. The links from the ancient time to the modern times, courtesy of the Gujarat University, developed, and we have good number of scholars from there, Mukesh Bhai, and of course, Ambassador Chinoy are example of it. Post-independence, Gujarat further linkages, Suzuki plant, and courtesy enlightened leadership by the then Chief Minister, Modi ji, that because of this relationship, went very, very strongly. In 2014, Modi sahab went there as Prime Minister. Prior to that, he had gone as Chief Minister. And that was the time when he was able to forge personal relationship with the Japanese Prime Minister. personal relationship with the Hogo governor. And when the old person had come, he was so happy that, yes, Mr. Modi knew me personally, and had I been young, I would have also tried for the prime ministership. But then he said, I am of a slightly higher age. I cannot really try for prime ministership. I am happy that Prime Minister Abe is there as prime minister. He hails from Hyogo, correct? I mean, Abe Saab hails from Hyogo area, and he said that Modi ji hails from Gujarat. So he was happy to be there. And we feel that when this province has its big festival sometime in September, our chief minister would also like to visit there. Well, the relationship is not only based on prime minister to prime minister. The relationship, as we could see, is built on Chamber of Commerce has contributed significantly. Just some time back, Mr. Jaimin Wasa, the chairman, Dr. Jaimin Wasa, had led a delegation. The members you saw, they stood up, they were clapped, they were welcomed, they were felicitated by all of us over here. This chamber also has contributed quite a lot to that relationship. And in fact, they have recently opened a particular a place for the Japanese businessman. They can come over here and they would feel at home there. So that is a desk they would provide for the Japanese MSMEs to come over here. The university, as I told you, the university has also played its big role in fostering this relationship. Industries, yes, of course. It's the Maruti Suzuki, which came from here, and the Indian industrialist, I mean, have also played a part. Recently, just very recently, yesterday only, we had a meeting of the MOUs or review of the MOUs. We could see that large number of companies of Indian ownership are here as ancillaries of the Suzuki plant. So they are all setting a plant over here. And because of that, our Gujarati students, Gujarati engineers, Gujarati workers will not only get labor directly, but indirectly also. So that would also help all of us. And finally, of course, the government has to be there to guide and sort of cajole everybody to have a good relationship. Friends, lots of MOUs have been signed. I would like once again request the ambassador to take a review of those MOUs, cajole somebody from the Japanese side, prod us also to move further in that. And this relationship has only to grow. It has got a strong foundation in economics. It has also got a strong foundation in the strategy. Because strategically, we all, both of the countries, both Japan and India, share a neighbor. I mean, it's a big neighbor. You cannot choose your neighbor. Just like you cannot choose your parents, you cannot choose your neighbor. So both of us have a very big neighbor, and that force that makes us come together. Japan also sees in India a rising power, an important power, financial, economic, strategic, and that would also be a big source for the growth of all of us. So friends, once again, I thank you. I thank Dr. Mukesh Patel for bringing us all together. And finally, my thanks to Ambassador Chinoy, who has been my very senior colleague, my very dear colleague. And fortunately, for the next 2 days, he is here with us. So wishing you once again, sir, a very, very bright career ahead. And we would certainly benefit from your erudition, your overall administrative capabilities, and your presence over here with all of us. Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir. That was truly a very vibrant and spirited address, you know, acknowledging not just the Ahmedabad Management Association and the Indo-Japan Friendships, also the Gujarat University, the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And just as the ambassador shares, you know, one man, 11 languages, for me, sir, these five institutions that you named, I've had the singular privilege of having headed all of them. So I'm extremely happy that it has been an association very close and dear with. We wish to thank you. And of course, the final words for the evening, as all the MA programs end on time, we start on time, we end on time,
That's the Japanese way, Your Excellency, and that's what we have learned, and we always wish, you know, because Japanese management is all about that. I would request the president of the Ahmedabad Management Association, Mr. Rajiv Mehta, to please come and deliver his concluding remarks and address. I know there are a lot of friends who have come here specially to meet His Excellency the Ambassador, maybe take pictures, etc. The Ambassador has agreed to spend some time, so feel free to take turns, come, interact with him. But for your closing remarks, Mr. Rajiv Mehta.
Thank you, Mukesh Bhai. I'm very pleased to have this closing remark, but I would like to mention here what Mukesh Bhai told and he read about our Prime Minister Modi's vision of mini Japan. Mukesh Bhai, I would like to say that AMA is a mini Japan. If you start, if you see, we have a Japan center. We have a person like Mukesh Patel in AMA who is awarded by Japan and leading us into the all Indo-Japan relationship. We had a beautiful MOU signed, and then Hyogo governor himself came to AMA, and we were able to do a very huge program for the SME. More than 200 SMEs attended that program, where the Japanese companies presented about their partners' need here. Madam Abe came to AMA, and His Excellency, the Ambassador, Mr. Sujan Chinoy, is here again, and we wish him that he comes, keep on coming here, as he has the roots here, he comes and ties with the roots, so he has now a new relationship with AMA, and he'll continue. So we thank him a lot to be here. Big round of applause from all of us to be part of this. We thank a lot the government of Gujarat, especially Honorable Singh Saab, for the presence and supporting us in this program. We have been receiving a lot of support from Index B, from Mr. Benival, who is also on the Governing Council Board of AMA. And we do a lot of joint program recently with Chamber of Commerce and Index B. We did a program of the SME. In AMA. So I think I really thank you to take time and come here to AMA and give your words and support and confidence that we will be able to do much better. I'm also thankful to Himanshu Bhai, my friend, and Jaimin Bhai, my friend, for supporting this program and being here from the university and the Chamber of Commerce. All the friends from Chamber of Commerce, the delegates of Japan, the exchange program people, and the Indo-Japan members. I thank all of you and all other people, the media, to be here on this program. Thank you very much, and wish you a very happy evening. Thank you very much.